Kidnapped by Robert Louis Stevenson, read by Robbie Coltrane. I will begin the story of my adventures with a certain morning in the month of June, the year of grace 1751, when I took the key for the last time out of the door of my father's house. By the time I had come as far as the manse, the mist that hung round the valley at dawn was beginning to arise and die away. Mr. Campbell, the minister of Essendean, was waiting for me by the garden gate. "Well, Davy lad," said he, "I will go with you as far as the ford to set you on your way." And we began to walk forward in silence. "Are you sorry to leave Essendean?" said he, after a while. "Why, sir," said I, "Essendean is a good place, but to speak the truth, if I thought I had a chance to better myself where I was going, I would go with a good will." "Aye," said Mr. Campbell, "then it behoves me to tell you your fortune, or so far as I may. When your mother was gone, and your father, the worthy Christian man, began to sicken for his end, he gave me a certain letter, which he said was your inheritance. So soon, says he, as I am gone, give my boy this letter and start him off to the House of Shaws, not far from Crammond. That is the place I came from." "The House of Shaws!" I cried. "What had my poor father to do with the House of Shaws?" "Nay, who can tell for a surety? But the name of that family is the name you bear, Balfour of Shaws, an ancient, reputable house. Your father, too, was a man of learning. No man more plausibly conducted school, nor had he the manner of a common dominie." He gave me the letter, which was addressed in these words: "To the hands of Ebenezer Balfour, Esquire of Shaws. These will be delivered by my son, David Balfour." My heart was beating hard. "Mr. Campbell, and if you were in my shoes, would you go?" "Of a surety," said the minister, "that would I. You should get to Crammond, which is near in by Edinburgh, in 2 days of walk. If the worst came to the worst, and your high relations, as I cannot but suppose them to be, should put you to the door, you can but walk the 2 days back again and risp at the man's door. And here, Davy," he resumed, "it lies near my conscience to set you on guard against the dangers of the world." With that, he took off his hat and prayed a little aloud, for a young man setting out into the world. Then suddenly embraced me very hard, then held me at arm's length, his face all working with sorrow, and then whipped about, and crying good-bye to me, set off the way we had come at a sort of jogging run. It might have been laughable to another, but I was in no mind to laugh. I watched him as long as he was in sight, and took my last look at Kirk Essendean, the trees about the manse, and the big rowans in the kirkyard where my father and mother lay. In the forenoon of the second day, coming to the top of a hill, I saw the country fall away before me down to the sea, and in the midst of this descent, on a long ridge, the city of Edinburgh, smoking like a kiln. There was a flag upon the castle, and ships moving or lying anchored in the firth, and both brought my country heart into my mouth. Presently after, I came by a house where a shepherd lived, and got a rough direction for the neighbourhood of Crammond. And so, from one direction to another, worked my way westward of the capital till I was told I was in Crammond Parish, and began to substitute in my inquiries the name of the House of Shaws. It was a word that seemed to surprise those of whom I sought my way. After two or maybe three had given me the same look and answer, I began to take it in my head there was something strange about the Shaws. It was drawing on to sundown when I met a stout, sour-looking woman coming trudging down a hill, and she, when I had put my usual question, turned sharp about, back to the summit she had just left, and pointed to a great bulk of a building standing very bare upon a green in the bottom of the next valley. The woman's face lit up with a malignant anger. "That is the House of Shaws," she cried. "Blood built it, blood stopped the building of it, blood shall bring it down. See here, I spit upon the ground and crack my thumb at it. Black be its fall. If you see the laird, tell him this makes the 1219th time that Jennet Clouston has called down the curse on him and his house, byre and stable." And the woman turned with a skip and was gone. I sat me down and stared at the House of Shaws. The more I looked, the pleasanter that countryside appeared, being all set with hawthorn bushes full of flowers, the fields dotted with sheep, and every sign of a kind soil and climate. And yet, the barrack in the midst of it went sore against my fancy. The nearer I got, the drearier it appeared. It seemed like the one wing of the house had never been finished. What should have been the inner end stood open on the upper floors and showed against the sky with steps and stairs of uncompleted masonry. The night had begun to fall as I got close, and in three of the windows, very high up and well barred, a little fire began to glimmer. I came forward cautiously, and giving ear, heard a little dry, eager cough that came in fits. The door was a great piece of wood all studded with nails. I knocked once, then I stood and waited. A whole minute passed away, and nothing stirred. Whoever was in that house kept deadly still and must have held his breath. I was in two minds whether to run away, but anger got the upper hand, and I began to rain kicks and buffets on the door. I was in full career when I heard the cough right overhead, and looking up beheld a man in a nightcap, and the bell mouth of a blunderbuss at one of the first-story windows.
"It's loaded," said a voice.
"I have come here with a letter," I said, "to Mr. Ebenezer Balfour of Shaw's. It is a letter of introduction."
"A what?"
I repeated what I had said.
"Who are ye, yourself?"
was the next question, after a considerable pause.
"I am not ashamed of my name. They call me David Balfour."
It was with a curious change of voice that the next question followed.
"Is your father dead?"
I was so much surprised at this that I could find no voice to answer.
"Aye," the man resumed, "he'll be dead, no doubt, and that'll be what brings ye chapping to my door. Well, man, I'll let ye in."
Presently there was a great rattling of chains and bolts, and the door was cautiously opened.
"Go into the kitchen and touch Nathan," said the voice,
and the person of the house set himself to replacing the defences of the door. I groped my way forward and entered the kitchen. The fire had burned up fairly bright and showed me the barest room I ever put my eyes on. Half a dozen dishes stood upon the shelves. The table was laid for supper with a bowl of porridge, a horn spoon, and a cup of small beer. There was not another thing in that great stone-vaulted chamber but lockfast chests against the wall and a corner cupboard with a padlock. The man rejoined me. He was a mean, stooping, clay-faced creature, his age anything between 50 and 70. He seemed like an old, unprofitable serving man.
"Are ye sharp set?" he asked. "You can eat that drop porridge?"
I said I feared it was his own supper.
"Oh, I can do fine wantin' it. Let's see the letter."
I told him the letter was for Mr. Balfour, not for him.
"And who do you think I am? Give me Alexander's letter," he returned. "Little as you seem to like either me or my house, I'm your born uncle, Davy, my man."
My uncle turned the letter over and over in his hands.
"Do you ken what's in it?"
he asked suddenly. "You see for yourself, sir, that the seal has not been broken."
"I was a secret man, Alexander, a secret, silent man. He never said muckle when he was young. He'll never have spoken muckle of me.
I never knew, sir, that he had any brother."
"Nor yet of Shaw's, I dare say."
"Not so much as the name, sir."
"To think of that. A strange nature of a man."
He seemed singularly satisfied, for presently he jumped up.
"I will agree fine yet," he cried. "I'm just as glad as I'll let you in. Now come and watch your bed."
To my surprise, he lit no lamp or candle, but set forth into the dark passage, groping his way up a flight of steps, and paused before a door. He bade me go in. I did as he bid, but begged a light to go to bed with.
"Hoot toot," said he. "Lights in a house is a thing I dinna agree with. I'm unco feared of fires. Good night, ye."
He pulled the door and I heard him lock me in. The room was as cold as a well and the bed as damp as a peat hag. By good fortune, I had caught up my bundle and my plaid, and rolling myself in the latter, I fell speedily asleep. With the first peep of day, I opened my eyes to find myself in a great chamber hung with stamped leather and furnished with fine embroidered furniture. 10 years ago, or perhaps 20, it must have been as pleasant a room as a man could wish, but damp, dirt, disuse, and mice had done their worst since then. I knocked and shouted till my jailer came and let me out. He carried me to the back of the house, where was a draw-well, and told me to wash there if I wanted. And when that was done, I made my way back to the kitchen, where he was making the porridge. When we had made an end of our meal, my Uncle Ebenezer sat at one of the windows and silently smoked. From time to time his eyes came coasting round to me, and he shot out one of his questions. Once it was,
"And your mother?"
And when I told him that she too was dead,
"Aye, she was a bonny lassie."
Then, after another long pause,
"Davy, my man, you've come to the right bit when you came to your uncle. have a great notion of the family, and I mean to do the right bit by you. What's mine is yours, Davy, and what's yours...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.